Hi, I'm Jim Ward of the Middle Country Public Library, and I'd like to welcome you to episode 24 in our History Bites series. Today, we will discuss the Baltimore plot and the assassination attempt on Abraham Lincoln prior to him being sworn in as president. November 6, 1860 was Election Day, and Americans went to the polls to choose a new president. Abraham Lincoln sat expectantly in the Springfield, Illinois telegraph office. The results came in around 2 a.m. Lincoln was elected president with a decisive Electoral College victory with 180 votes over his opponent's combined total of 123 votes. Even as jubilation erupted around him, he calmly kept watch until the results came in from Springfield, confirming that he had carried the town he had called home for a quarter century. Only then did he return home to wake Mary Todd Lincoln, exclaiming to his wife, "Mary, Mary, we are elected." However, 10 of the 15 states that allowed slavery refused to vote for him. Slave owners feared that Lincoln, already opposed to the extension of slavery into new territories, would use the powers of the presidency to end slavery in the United States. In response to his election, South Carolina became the first state to secede on December 20, 1860. By February 1, 1861, Mississippi, Florida, Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, and Texas had followed suit. This placed the future of the country in jeopardy and put President-elect Abraham Lincoln in a potentially perilous position. In early 1861, Lincoln hired John Nicolay, a young Bavarian immigrant, to be his personal secretary. Nicolay saw most of the correspondence coming in for Lincoln and was appalled at the number of threats made against the president-elect. His mail was infested with brutal and vulgar menace, and warnings of all sorts came to him from zealous or nervous friends. But he had himself so sane a mind and a heart so kindly even to his enemies that it was hard for him to believe in political hatred so deadly as to lead to murder, Nicolay wrote. It was clear, however, that not all the warnings could be brushed aside. In the coming weeks, the task of planning Lincoln's railway journey to his inauguration in the nation's capital on March 4, 1861, would present daunting logistical and security challenges. The task would prove all the more formidable because Lincoln insisted that he utterly disliked ostentatious display and empty pageantry, and would make his way to Washington without a military escort. Instead of taking precautions, Lincoln insisted on making the 2,000-mile, 13-day journey through numerous cities including Cleveland, Indianapolis, Cincinnati, Buffalo, Albany, New York City, Philadelphia, Harrisburg, and Baltimore in an effort to promote national unity. On February 11, 1861, Lincoln departed Springfield after delivering a somber address to the crowd, quote, "My friends, no one, not in my situation, can appreciate the feeling of sadness at this parting. To this place and the kindness of these people, I owe everything. Here I have lived a quarter of a century and have passed from a young to an old man. Here my children have been born, and one is buried. I now leave, not knowing when or whether ever I may return, with a task before me greater than that which rested upon Washington. Without the assistance of that divine being, whoever attended him, I cannot succeed. With that assistance, I cannot fail. Trusting in him, who can go with me and remain with you and be everywhere for good, let us confidently hope that all will yet be well. To his care, commending you, as I hope in your prayers you will commend me, I bid you an affectionate farewell." Samuel Morse Felton, president of the Philadelphia, Wilmington, and Baltimore Railroad, worried about the safety of his railroad operations after catching wind of plots to sabotage his rail lines. He was particularly worried about Maryland, specifically the city of Baltimore. A significant section of Felton's railroad ran through Maryland, and although it was still part of the Union, in the winter of 1861, Maryland was a slave state vigorously debating secession in the state legislature. If war did break out, Felton's railroad would be vital for the transport of soldiers and ammunition. At this point, Felton called upon the services of famed Scottish detective Alan Pinkerton, head of the Pinkerton National Detective Agency in Chicago, Illinois. On January 21, 1861, Felton met with Pinkerton in Philadelphia to discuss the threats. After the meeting, Pinkerton sprang into action. First, he sent Felton a detailed plan for railroad protection and stressed the importance of secrecy in carrying out the arrangement. Then Pinkerton set out for Baltimore with some of his best detectives. At this point, Felton and Pinkerton were both more concerned with safeguarding the railroad than a possible assassination attempt on Lincoln. After sending his detectives out to survey Baltimore, Pinkerton established his headquarters at an office under the disguise of John H. Hutchinson, a stockbroker. Along with his assistant Harry Davies, Pinkerton went deeper undercover and frequented the pubs and taverns of Baltimore, conversing with secessionists and mixing with Baltimore businessmen. He investigated possible threats to the PW&B Railroad and discovered that police forces, government officials, and many citizens in Baltimore were sympathetic to the secessionists. After making contact with stockbroker James H. Luckett, Pinkerton accidentally stumbled upon a plot to assassinate Lincoln. Through Luckett, Pinkerton learned of a small group of men interested in Lincoln's stop in Baltimore. Luckett introduced Pinkerton to the man heading up the assassination plot, an Italian barber named Cipriano Ferrandini. Pinkerton described the plot as follows. A row or fight was to be got up by some outsiders to quell, which the few policemen at the depot would rush out, thus leaving Mr. Lincoln entirely unprotected and at the mercy of a mob of secessionists who were to surround him at that time. A small steamer had been chartered and was lying in one of the bays or little streams running into the Chesapeake, to which the murderers were to flee, and it was immediately put off for Virginia. At each stop, Lincoln delivered public addresses and attended celebrations in his honor. In his speeches, he expressed his commitment to preserving the Union. He traveled with his family and his two private secretaries, John Nicolay and John Hay. For protection, several military personnel and his friend and personal bodyguard, Ward Hill Lehman, accompanied Lincoln. Pinkerton dispatched a message to Lincoln's supporter and confidant, Norman Judd, upon discovery of the assassination plot. On February 21st, Pinkerton traveled to Philadelphia to divulge the facts of his investigation to Felton and Judd. Alarmed by his findings, Judd quickly arranged a meeting with Lincoln. And on that same day, Lincoln met Pinkerton, who outlined the threats that would be faced in Baltimore if the president-elect were to stay on schedule. Although Lincoln refused to diverge from his scheduled activities, he did allow Judd and Pinkerton to adjust his travel to Washington, D.C. after he fulfilled all of his obligations. Lincoln spent February 22nd in Harrisburg. At 5 p.m., he dined with Pennsylvania Governor Andrew Curtin. At 5:45 p.m., he excused himself from dinner and left the venue through the back door to travel to Philadelphia for the train to Baltimore. According to Lincoln's recollection, a comical scene unfolded. While in New York several days prior, a friend gifted Lincoln a new beaver hat in a box. Upon leaving the Harrisburg dinner, Lincoln pulled this new hat from his pocket and placed it on his head. A far cry from his famous top hat, the beaver hat served as a clever disguise. Once back in Philadelphia, Pinkerton and Lehman escorted the president-elect aboard a train scheduled to depart for Baltimore at 11 p.m. Pinkerton noted that Lincoln remained cold, calm, and collected. So as not to arouse suspicion, the small party traveled aboard a public train car, taking their place in back of the sleeping car. Pinkerton's agent, Kate Warren, reserved four sleeping berths for the party, posing as the sister of an invalid traveler. At 3:30 a.m., the small party arrived to Baltimore's President Street Depot. Rail workers hitched the sleeping car to a team of horses, pulling the car a mile through the streets of Baltimore to the Camden Street Station. At this point, the car was attached to a new train, and the party proceeded to Washington, D.C. At 6 a.m. on February 23rd, they arrived safely at the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad Depot, successfully foiling any conspiracy to end Lincoln's life. Lincoln took a carriage to the Willard Hotel to prepare for his inauguration. Abraham Lincoln was sworn into office on March 4, 1861, and offered a conciliatory message to the South, quote, "We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies. Though passion may have strained, it must not break our bonds of affection. The mystic cords of memory stretching from every battlefield and patriot grave to every living heart and hearthstone all over this broad land will yet swell the chorus of the Union, when again touched, as surely they will be, by the better angels of our nature." The Civil War would begin with the attack on the Federal installation at Fort Sumter on April 12, 1861, and would continue for four bloody years. Lincoln lived just long enough to witness Union victory, but was shot by John Wilkes Booth while attending a performance at Ford's Theater and died on April 15, 1865. Lincoln's funeral train would return to Springfield on the same train route he took in 1861 to assume office. He is now buried at Oak Ridge Cemetery in Springfield. To learn more about the Baltimore Plot, check out these two books, The Baltimore Plot by Michael J. Klein and The Hour of Peril by Daniel Stashower. Contact Adult Reference to reserve your copy today. I'd like to thank you all for joining us for today's episode. If you enjoyed it, click like, and if you watched on YouTube, hit subscribe. Thanks so much, and we'll see you all next time.